Kara. Welcome to Kara's Basement. While Fall Out Boy is taking a break, lead singer Patrick Stump is putting out a solo album. It's called Soul Punk, comes out in October, and Patrick Stump is in Kara's Basement. Hey, Patrick.
Hi, how you doing?
I'm awesome. How are you?
I'm good.
All right, so I have to tell you, first of all, that you are looking amazing. I mean, just it's stellar how great you look. And I don't want to say you're unrecognizable because it kind of insinuates that you weren't so stellar looking before, but I always thought you were a good-looking guy. But you went through, like, a transformation.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I guess I am kind of unrecognizable because I just hid behind a lot of stuff before. I would have the hat, and I mm-hmm. had the, you know, glasses and the sideburns and things, you know, all that stuff. And then obviously I lost a lot of weight, so I think all of that combined, you know, it's kind of a surprise. But then at the same time, I feel like I just look like myself again,
right?
You know, because when I see pictures from high school and stuff, that's just, you know, it's just that guy. it's weirder to me that I wore a hat every day for, I don't know, 8 years.
What happened to the hat? Did you donate it somewhere?
We ended up donating them. I couldn't find anything to do with it. I didn't want to do anything cheesy where it was like, you know, auction lot or something.
Right.
I was like, I'm just going to donate them.
Yeah. So you mentioned high school, and that, of course, was, you know, here. What was it, Glenbrook? Where'd you go?
Glenbrook South.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you for getting it right. Because I feel like no one knows who we are. You know, every time I'm like, yeah, I'm from Glenview. And they're like, oh, so you went to Glenbard South?
So. Glen something. Were you? And I say this because I was actually a choir nerd. Were you a choir nerd kind of a guy in high school?
I was not. I tried out for choir a couple times. I was too. I guess because I was a punk rocker, mm-hmm. so whatever. I was too, like,
too cool.
I wasn't interested enough. I kind of regret it because I wanted to do it. There was a really great music teacher at my high school that who did the choir, who really wanted me to do it, but I just never. I was too much of a punk about it.
Well, did you have any vocal training? Because you're incredible. You're singing. In fact, my daughter, when she found out I was talking to you, he's only the best singer in the world, was what she said to me.
That's not true at all. But thank you. I'm a drummer by trade. That's what I learned. That's what I studied for, you know, when I was younger. That's how I got into music. So the singing thing, and I talked to a lot of other musicians that have had this happen to them, but, you know, I think when you're so in music, you just don't even really consider whether or not people can sing, you
mm-hmm.
know? It's just a thing that you just, everybody can sing.
That makes,
you know,
sense, like, with a lot of bands.
It's like when you talk, I'm a terrible athlete, right? It's like when you talk to you know, I have some friends who, like, really love to play sports and stuff, and they're like, and, you know, you talk to them, and you know, like, yeah, I want to go throw the ball around. I'm like, yeah, I'm not good at, they're like, that's just throwing the ball around, you'll be fine. I'm like, no, I'm not good at that. Like, I'm not good at any of it. You know, like, it's the same kind of thing where you don't have, I guess I didn't realize that people could or could not sing, and I never really tried to be a singer. It was just I don't know, the band needed a singer, and we didn't have one, so I stepped in, I guess. I don't know.
That's awesome, because it takes a lot of guts to be a singer, not even just besides the actual voice part, just standing there, everyone's looking at you.
I think that might have contributed to the sideburns and the glasses and the hats and stuff. I think it's really easy to hide,
right.
to not feel like it's you, you know, when you're, you know, to not really, like, I remember seeing something, DMC, from Run DMC, who was talking about how in the 80s, you know, he had the persona that was the hat and glasses, and then when he would go off stage, he was just Daryl, you know.
Right.
That's kind of how I feel about it. So, but now I think I'm kind of just embracing just me in front of people again, you know, like, I think you get older, you get more confident, I guess.
Right.
You either get more confident or you just stop caring.
I was going to say, it's kind of interesting that now that you don't have an actual band, because you can sort of fall, I guess, was sort of a pun there, but, you know, sort of fall behind your bandmates too, and not always be the main guy out in front. And now that you've got Soul Punk coming out, it is just you, and now you're not hiding behind the sideburns and hats, so you are out there.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. You know, it's definitely weird, because I realized today I did another interview earlier, and I was leaving, and I was like, like I do interviews and stuff, and I like talk, and a radio station is playing my song. These are like all, this is all, it's all you now, mm-hmm. Patrick. You know, it was a very weird, like, I was driving home and I was like, well, the gang's all here.
Yep. You know?
it was just kind of funny, like, you know, kind of realizing how much of it's on my shoulders, I guess. So it's, you know, you can't really, you have to take it seriously at that point, because if you get lazy, the whole show gets lazy.
Right, exactly. So. You know, it's funny that you say that, because it just dawned on me. I actually was your moderator of your press conference for the Nike Human Race at Soldier Field a couple of years ago.
Yeah, that's right.
And I remember thinking, you know, it seemed like you weren't talking very much. You know, not that you want to, but it was hard, you know, with all those people there.
Yeah, I mean, it's I'm not one of those. I'm not the type of person that, by nature, walks into a room and like owns a room. You know, it's just not. It's not part of me. So when there's three other people there, I kind of clam up. You know, it kind of. There wasn't really, you know, I would answer the very informative questions that everyone else was tired of answering. But
right. But
you know, when it came to actually conversing and stuff, I kind of just let everybody else have it, you know, because you know, it was more, I felt like it was more their thing. And that's another thing, is that now I just have to do it. Now,
right.
Now there's no excuse. So
your new album, so many great songs on it. I'm interested in the sound of the album. You can't really even describe it. I actually told a friend of mine, it kind of reminds me of Michael Bublé if he sang punk rock, you know.
That's crazy. I kind of like that.
Well,
awesome.
So I think it might be the suit that you're always wearing, but the video.
I do. I have a great suit.
This City with Lupe Fiasco. How'd that song come to be? I know we're playing it at the Mix at Night on You Mix It. People are actually voting to hear it, which is pretty cool.
That's very cool.
Yeah.
That's you know, I'm grateful that anyone wants to hear it. that song actually kind of changed my record for me, because up to then my record had this. It was kind of scatterbrained. It was like the sound was really all over the place. There were some more, I don't even know. I mean, more instrumentally based sections and stuff like that. It was a different album, and I wrote This City like absolute last minute, like 11th hour. You know, in fact, we had finished tracking, we were about to master, and I wrote the song, and I was like, and I called somebody up. I was like, we have to record this like today. You know, whatever, get in the studio, record it, and we finish it, and we're like, well, now this doesn't sound like the record at all. Now we have to, like, I called management, I was like, I pretty much have to go back and re-record my record, because I want it to sound like this song.
Mm.
I liked the song so much that I wanted to make my, you know, kind of reshape my record around it. So, it's a pretty, you know, important song to the record in itself, and then Lupe got involved because the label had suggested to me, you know, having a remix or having an MC on a version, and that was like, he was pretty much it for me. He was the guy I wanted for it. So, and he did it.
That's a sweet song. You know, you're going to be at Lollapalooza and the BMI stage on Saturday, August 6th. And as it turns out, Pete Wentz's band, Black Cards, is going to be there the day before. So you guys are going to both be at Lollapalooza. Does that mean there's the possibility of any sort of a little Fall Out Boy reunion of some sort, somewhere, sometime?
No. I really, you know, I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings or anything, but you know, if you are buying tickets with that in mind, if you're considering buying tickets, please don't. If that's what you want to see, we won't be doing that. But you know, I'm gonna check out Black Cards if I can, and we're definitely gonna hang out, because I haven't seen them in a minute. So we're still really good friends, and you know, we are still a band. There's just no real plans, but I know for sure, because Andy and Joe aren't even going to be in the country, I don't think. So.
All right, well, that answers that question. I had to ask, because I'm sure people will be wondering.
Oh, yeah, no, it's come up a few times, but I just feel bad, because, you know, it's like these rumors kind of start, and then it becomes, you know, it kind of gets out of control real fast. We're like, there's another, I've heard of all these shows that Fall Out Boy is supposedly playing in the past couple weeks, and I'm like, what? We're not doing anything.
Jeez. So I mentioned earlier how my daughter's a big fan, and she actually sent me two questions to ask you, so I'll close this by asking
her
questions, because they're good questions. The first one was, where do you see your career going?
I have no idea. I mean, I have a lot of contingency plans as far as, like, you know, like, if I can't, you know, afford to do it anymore, kind of thing. You know, like if it all goes south or whatever, I can, I don't know, maybe I'll just get a day job and still put out records on my, you know, for fun, whatever. I really don't know. I mean, I could see it going any way, basically, you know.
You do so much producing for other people. You know, there's always going to be something for you.
Yeah, you know, and that's another thing is depending on how I put a lot of that on hold for a while to focus on this record, but you know, I'm looking forward to getting back into producing, so I'm sure that's going to be something coming up, you know.
Her second question is, what's it like being so awesome?
I don't know what it's like to be awesome. I know what it's like to be me, but
so you're awesome and question. Modest.
I was doing an interview today with California, like, you know, mm-hmm. the station was in California, and they were and we were talking, and I was like, and over the course of it, he's like, you're really polite, man. And I was like, I'm from the Midwest. We can't not. It's just like yes, there are some rude Chicago drivers. Yes, there are all the things, but we can't help it.
Right. Like, well, I appreciate you talking to me. Thank you. We'll see you at Lollapalooza for sure.
Yeah, I'm psyched to be there, and thank you so much for having me.
Now what if I told you my city was the best, and my city was a threat to the rest? And my city was a threat to the rest.
This city is my city, and I love it. Yeah, I love it. I was born.